I'll tell you what, I don't know what they did in that car, but it stinks. Welcome to An MG Is Born. Yes, we're building an MG, and what a fantastic company Morris Garages was. They built a road roller version. They built a double decker. But then sadly, it all went very pear-shaped, and they built that. Now, he said I'd find him in a white garage with a red door. Thank you, Jeremy, very helpful. Yes, I'm here to meet Mr. MG in my part of the world. His name's Jeremy, and he's gonna help me find the vehicle I'm gonna restore. Aha! Well, it's not that one then. I'll tell you what, he packs them in. Very nice, but I don't like rubber bumpers. Jeremy? Tell you what, Jeremy is a very elusive man, but he's got some nice cars here. This is a 3-litre straight six 1968 MGC. It's not the car for me, it's a left-hand drive for starters, but it is nice. And so is this. This is a GT. Doo-doo. Hardtop, permanent, very nice car, and very special because this is one of only 580 cars built like this in pewter silver, and one of the last 1,000 MGBs ever built. A bit too modern for me. And I don't want a GT. It ain't enough cold in here. I tell you what, this is very familiar and maybe a taste of things to come. Jeremy? Feet?
Fuck!
Ooh, very nice. Finished ones. This is what I hope mine will look like, or something like it, probably a different colour. Jeremy! Aha! I tell you what, you are a very difficult man to find. Right, I need some help to find the car I want to restore. I'm keen on an MGB Roadster. It has to be a chrome bumper, but I can't kind of make my mind up whether it should be a 60s car or an early 70s car.
Depends on what you want to use the car for. If you're using it as a high days and holidays car, then you could go for something that a collector would go for, which would be a much earlier car. If you want to use it for everyday, you can go for a slightly later car, so sort of like mid-70s.
So what exactly is it, though, that makes the later ones more drivable?
Gearbox is different for a start, because the early cars had what they called a three synchro gearbox, no synchro in first. The later cars, you have got synchromesh on all four gears, and it's a much tougher, stronger gearbox.
In terms of actually carrying out the restoration, obviously spare parts is a big issue for me as a kind of hobby builder. Are they readily available right across the range from the very early cars to the latest of the chrome bumpers?
Essentially, the engineering and all the parts used are basically all the same. So, like, your shock absorber would have been used from 62 right till the end of production in 81. So there are only minor changes, as I said, like switch gear. They're different trim stuff, they're all different, but the range of parts and availability is very, very good.
What are the most likely problems I'm going to face?
Probably rust. Mechanical components are very tough, very long lasting. They don't tend to give a lot of trouble. Agricultural, I think somebody describes them as, but no, the engines are very tough.
Okay, this is quite interesting because I've been very focused on a 60s car. I don't know why, but I have. You're now saying that potentially an early 70s car might be more suitable to me.
Some of the 70s cars were very, very good. In fact, they went from very, very good to very, very bad. If you remember back in the 70s, we had the Steel Strikes. And in fact, the very first of the rubber bumper cars, which were built very late 75 and early 76, are made of cheap imported steel, are renowned for being very bad at rusting. Whereas literally a year prior to that, 74, were actually very, very well built. And in fact, we have some cars now that are driving around that are still on their original bodies.
The big question is, can you help me find a car?
I think I might be able to. I have an idea where I might be able to locate a car for you.
One last question. Have you ever thought about possibly having a slightly bigger office? Because there's not much space in here, is there,
No,
Pete?
No, it's all right.
Really?
No, we're doing our best, Mark.
Speed you.
Yeah, OK. Can we cut?
Should we get on now? Jeremy said I had to come here to a chicken shed. It's virtually in the middle of nowhere, which is full of fantastic old MGs, but I am looking for an M-registered one, 156M. There's another MGC. Rubber bumper, rubber bumper. Old Landy, very nice too. Hillman, yes! Aha! 156M, this is the baby. Not sure about the colour. But hey, Pete, what do you think?
Very nice.
It's all right, isn't it? It's right, it's a 74 car, it's chrome bumpered, Rostar wheels. This could be the one. What we need to do is get it out of here into the daylight. Unfortunately, a rather lovely old Wolseley's in the way, so we have to move that as well. And then we can have a look at it and see if we can do a deal. Thank you very much. Thank you. Lovely. Doesn't look quite so pretty in the daylight, though, does it? Look at Les. He's going to have a grump on now.
I've signed nothing yet.
Oh, that is horrible. This wing's completely shot. Jeremy?
Yes?
Are you pulling the flanker here?
Nope. Standard sort of restoration panels would be wings, doors, rear wings.
You're very confident and relaxed about this, aren't you?
I know. I've done it before.
It's me and him's got to do it. Yeah,
several
exactly.
times.
It's all right for you.
And I'm going to love watching you.
Deal. All right.
OK.
Deal for 1,100. See, you shook before I told you the price. 1,100 and we'll take it away. Les, meet your new companion for the next 5 months, OK?
Now you, I'm frightened.
You, me and that. The MGB Roadster is the quintessential British two-door, two-seater sports car. Launched in 1962, it was an instant hit. The critics loved this simple, robust little car. The 1800cc engine is easily maintained and will give you 22 miles to the gallon, and will do up to 100 miles an hour with no fuss. The MGB stayed in production for an incredible 18 years. During this time, around 500,000 cars were built, making it the best-selling MG ever. At the height of production, 45,000 cars were produced each year, and of those, 39,000 were shipped out to the States. But what does its designer think is the secret of its success?
It is very predictable to drive. It taps you on the shoulder when you're overdoing it in a corner, so you just back off a little bit and you can get a car around the car smoothly. And in my opinion, that is because it's rear-wheel drive. A lot of modern cars are front-wheel drive and they don't compare in the predictable handling that MGB has got. And the thing is, particularly with open car, you can actually smell the hay in the field. You're much nearer to your motoring than you are in these tin boxes.
Our first job now we've got it in the workshop is actually to see whether the engine will turn over and if possible we can get it running. Then we'll try and get it out down the farm track and drive it to see whether we've got gears and so on. But before we turn the engine over, it has been standing for about 3 years, this car. We need to do a little bit of work on it just in case there's anything gone on inside since. So we've drained out the oil. We'll put fresh oil in it just in case it's got any grot in it. Also change the oil filter. We'll take the spark plugs out and we'll turn it over by hand first to make sure that if something like a valve is stuck, if you turn it over by hand, you'll feel that. Obviously, if you're doing it on a starter motor, you could seriously damage something. So we'll whip a few bits out, lubricate it up, and then give it a go.
It's actually quite good, that.
Do the old sniff test, see if there's any petrol in the oil. And that smells very oily and not at all petrol-y, so that's good. We'll just spray some light machine oil down the bores just to help lubricate them a bit. So the plugs are out, we haven't put any oil back in yet, so all I want to do whilst there's no compression in the cylinders is just try and turn it over by hand to check everything is free and moving. And there's nothing sticking at all, which is good because via the cam, I also know that the valves can't be sticking open or anything, otherwise the piston could have hit one and then I wouldn't be able to move it. So it all feels very good to me. Right, so we've done all the checks. So basically we know the engine's not seized. We also know that we've got a spark to the spark plugs. From a fuel point of view, we've poured fuel, nice clean fuel, through the filter here to fill the bowls. We've unscrewed the dampers on the carburetors, which means the pistons can move up and down more easily. So in principle, it should work. So Pete, you're on the ignition.
Okay, Pete.
Yeah, here we go.
It's not firing at all. Well, we've checked over all the electrics and we've got sparks, so that isn't a problem. So we're going to try again and put some more volatile aromatics out of a can into the carburetors to try and get the thing cranked up. So, Pete, yeah. Foot to the floor yeah. And turn it over.
Here we go.
Hey! Yes, so we got clouds of smoke out of the back. That is such a classic MGB sound, isn't it? I mean, that's all right, that.
Got oil pressure, by the way.
Got oil pressure. No, I'm pleased with that. Switch it off for now. Well, there you go. That's been 3 years and it hasn't been used at all. We've just pulled it out of a barn and apart from just putting some new oil in it, no new parts and it's running. So that's got to be a good omen. After the break, we might strip some of the accessory bits of it, but before we take the engine out or anything major like that, we need to go down the farm track and see if we've got some gears. We'll see you after the break. Welcome back to An MG Is Born. Who's nicked my steering wheel? Now, as you can see, we've stripped a lot out of this vehicle already, but we're doing it in a much more slow and considered way than a normal project. And the reason is, even if you only leave a few weeks between stripping a car out and trying to rebuild it, you forget where all the little bits go. So this is the most useful bit of kit that we have on this project so far, a digital camera. And what we're doing is, with a mate of mine, we're actually writing a computer program to log all the strip details of this, all the parts we take off, everything's photographed and logged, so when we come and rebuild it again, we can go back to the computer and it'll show us exactly where everything fits. But the very next job, before we carry on stripping the vehicle to bits, is to check the gearbox. We know the engine's running, that's fine. We need to check we've got all the gears and also the overdrive work. So next, it's outside. Most ridiculous place to test a little sports car like this on a farm on a farm track. It's all getting very cosy in here. But look, I mean, she's running, she's driving in first. That's got to be good, isn't it? Second, third, very nice, no crunching. That's all four gears. Good job these are private roads, see? Right, into reverse. We have reverse as well. What we also need to check, though, is very important, is the overdrive, because these overdrive units, these overdrive units that they've got in here, and there's a switch for overdrive there, normal up, overdrive on. Some people had problems with these, with the switch gear that's at the gearbox end in terms of stopping you putting overdrive in first, second and reverse. And when that happened, because the switch gear in here is quite difficult to get to, they just shorted the wires out. And shorting out the wires was a big mistake because it means you could get overdrive if you switched it on in first, second and reverse, in all gears in fact. But it has a one-way clutch in the overdrive unit, which if you rotate it the wrong way, absolutely knackers it. So we want to check it works, but also that it's switching it properly and it isn't going to be available in first and second in reverse. So, right, start her up and we'll go back down the track. So that's first, second, let's see if we can put overdrive in. Okay, but do we have it in third and fourth? So that's third. At this speed, it's difficult to tell whether we got overdrive in third, but I don't think we have. But basically, the four gears and reverse are fine. There's no crunching or anything, which is good news. It's just the overdrive situation. Sweet little car, though, really comfortable. This is going to be a cracking car when we finish. Now, the bumpy old farm tracks were not the ideal surface on which to be testing the overdrive, so we've got a little experiment coming up. What they did test, though, was the suspension. All four wheels are in place, but the two rear ones are now off the ground, courtesy of the jacks, because we want to start it up, Pete. Put it in gear and allow the wheels to turn. Now, I'm not suggesting you do this at home, OK? Which is why we've got a nice trajectory into the field if the jacks collapse. And it's also why my techie is driving and not me. Pete, put it in third, bring it up to about 40 miles an hour and then keep it at that speed and then put on the overdrive. And what we're looking for is effectively the speed to increase a little bit with overdrive and obviously drop back when you switch it off again. Third and fourth is fine. Excellent, stops, not so well, but it stops. And also we've checked that it doesn't switch in second, which is really critical. So that's good. Good test, that. Pete, if you can get it off the jacks, mate, I've just got something to do. This is our test viewer here. Hello, darling. All right? Are you not feeling very well? You're not happy? No? You're all right? Well, why the long face?
The 1963 MGB Roadster, 1800cc, three bearing crankshaft engine, three sync gearbox. A few pals of mine had heard of the vehicle that was parked in a farmyard. I paid £600 for it and wheeled it home. And then gradually took the thing to pieces to realise that it was in a really, really sorry state. It's called a basket shell, and probably only about 20% were salvageable. The idea is to strip as much off as you can, to rebuild as much as you can, and then weld back on the pieces. The engine is brand new, in as much that it's a rebuilt engine, as is the gearbox and the overdrive. I'm particularly proud to show off all the bits and pieces under the bonnet. Many of them are fabricated by myself, and if they're not, they are modelled around parts that are attainable, and keeping it clean and keeping it all in working order is quite a lengthy part of the hobby. I totted up the hours, and it comes to just under 3,000 man-hours. And I try to keep it from the wife, but it's cost me just under £13,000 in parts and assistance. I would never get my money back, but I would do another one tomorrow.
So the dismantling continues. Lots of use of the old camera, but also these little labels. So particularly for the wiring, I can identify where everything goes. It may well be that the wiring's been fiddled with by previous owners, but at least I know what it's like now, and we can work it out later when we rewire it to make sure everything works properly. Rather nice little courtesy light here, which Pete, you hate, don't you? You don't think it's the original?
No.
I think it is the original, but the lens is gone. Anyway, that can all be stowed away. I've also released all the fixings for the windscreen, which is basically two bolts either side and then two bolts in the middle here. And Pete, this should be able to lift out now. If you can give us a hand, should just come up and then sort of rotate forwards. Like that?
Easy.
Nice one, huh?
Awesome. All right.
And there we have. Yeah, that was it's fixing that side. So
have you got it?
Yeah, I've got it. You can see actually the windscreen's cracked here. And it's also started to delaminate, so we're gonna have to put a new screen in anyway, but the frame is in pretty good nick. Just keep holding on there, Pete. If you start feeling faint, don't drop it on the head.
Oh no!
Oi! You did that on purpose. Pete, sorted. Next bit we're taking off is all the bright work. Obviously, the biggest bits of that are the front and rear bumpers. What we've noticed on the back bumper is this quite big crease where somebody's reversed it into something, maybe a bollard or a wall. And it's quite a good idea whilst it's still on the car to get that back into shape because it's fixed rigidly to the car. And you can also get a perspective of it to make sure it looks right when it's in place. We're actually going to bother doing that to this particular bumper because I want to keep it and re-chrome it rather than buying a brand new bumper with new chrome on it, because the new ones tend not to be fantastic in terms of their chrome quality. So I'm going to get this one redone. Now the technique to do this is I'm just going to use a couple of adjustable spanners done up nice and tight against the bumper, and then quite carefully where it needs pulling out, just gently put a bit of pressure on to just squeeze it out. Well, there you go, you can feel it move. You just need to put enough pressure on and then it just slightly goes. What also happens though is at the edge of the crease it starts to bulge out, so I'm going to have to knock that back into place. And it's a bit of trial and error really, just to keep doing it slowly, little bits at a time, until it looks about right. So I need to knock that in now. A nylon hammer is the tool for the job to knock this crease back in on the edge there. Gone back nicely, but it hasn't gone back completely. So I'll just have to use a metalworking hammer and a dolly just to finish that off. But that's already looking much better. So that just slots up in there. It's important to use a hammer that's slightly rounded on the edges so you don't actually put a crease in it with the edge of the hammer. Okay, it's not perfect yet, a little bit more tweaking, but that is looking so much better. Nice one, Pete. Yeah. Grab this. Oh, I don't know about you, but I'm exhausted. The top hose to come off. Pete, can you grab that foil cooler? The next thing to come out is the engine off the gearbox. And slowly, the car is getting lighter and lighter.
What are we doing?
We're trying to do whatever's necessary to get home and have a cup of tea. We're basically taking the engine off the gearbox.
Go on, sir.
All right, leave it there. What a beauty. One B-series engine surgically removed from the heart of the car. So that was a bit of a struggle, particularly because Les had to disappear halfway through that to help out a mate of ours whose trike had broken down. We got there and we've earned a beer. We'll see you next time.